So, friends, I think Dr. Chauhan, I told many things about Dr. Chaubey, and whatever we say, it will always be very less about Dr. Chaubey. He is truly a legend as far as surgery is concerned in India. He is one of the legends in particularly laparoscopic surgery of India. So, he is Dr. I introduce Dr. Padmasri, Dr. Pradeep Chaubey. He is the director of minimal invasive and laparoscopic robotic surgery department of Max Hospital. We all know he was in Gangaram Hospital for a quite long period, maybe more than 20 years. And then he has been in Max for last around 10 to 15 years. So he is a well known figure all over India, outside India. Everybody, wherever you go outside India, everybody knows Dr. Pradeep Chaubey. He is an internationally famed surgeon. He is also got doctorate from many universities. So if we give his introduction, it will take at least half an hour. So it suffices to say he is one of the legends of Indian surgeon. And please welcome Dr. Pradeep Chaubey. He will speak on laparoscopic to robotic surgery. We all know there are many advantages of robotic surgery. There may be some disadvantage also, like cost and maybe some less feeling of tactile sensation, but which may be overcome by the better visualization by 3D camera and other. We will hear from the legend. So I request Dr. Chaubey to start.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a great honor, great pleasure to be with you all after such a long time, not only the COVID but also the sadness and the medical fraternity what we all faced, not with our own family and friends, but also we have seen such a bad phase of this century. And I must compliment all of you and all of the doctor fraternity for doing excellent job at the cost of their family, time, and also at the big risk of losing life and suffering. So with that note, and I feel that the evening has been already made such a light evening, and I would not like to go much into details about what we are talking. Maybe I will talk something about my feelings. I started laparoscopic surgery 32 years back in India. And this December, last December 21, we have completed 92,000 operations, and we have been fortunate to be there at various books of record across the globe. And I bring greetings from our minimal access surgery department. And this is my first slide. And this I started showing my first lectures in 90s when I was taking, and I used to, and this making a slide at that time by a computer took almost full day because there was nothing which was available. But you know, that was my mind, my expression which was captured by the computer creator, and this was my feeling. Of course, this was a young feeling 32 years back. There was a, you know, we were all doing laparoscopic conventional surgery, but we were taking a leap towards the flower, thinking that this flower is going to be the thing to achieve and thing to acquire. We were not sure about the space here, whether this space is as solid as the previous generation space, but we were very confident that we will do it. And I'm showing this slide again after 32 years because we have taken another leap of faith after laparoscopy, after 32 years, and that is the robotic surgery. Now, I know that a lot of questions will be asked, and you can make out that's a very old picture, and this is how we used to work, looking at the monitor, and the cameras are here, and all our colleagues, which fortunately, they are still with me, and except the gray hair, they have full enthusiasm in their this thing. And this is what our vision was, that we should be able to convert all the abdominal surgeries and chest surgeries into the laparoscopic surgeries. And fortunately, over a period of time, we have shown that endoscopic surgery is not good only for gallbladder, not for hernia only, not for bariatric, not for uterus, but also for very odd organs like the pheochromocytoma, adenoids, spleen. I have done a lot of neck work for thyroid and parathyroid. Still we do scarless neck surgery. And also, I, you know, 30 years back, we were doing the retroperitoneoscopy for pyelonephritis, nephrectomies, and things like that. So I think a lot of us, at the beginning, we have said a lot of water has flown under the bridge. The sure is the technology. And we know that a couple of years back, we got a mobile phone where we could just speak, and it was costing 60 rupees per minute, whether it's an incoming call or an outgoing call. And now we know that. So I will be talking about the cost as well as. So today by evening, I will try to explain you both things about the technological development and the development on the cost. Now you see, I think this is a vision. Now what happened, when we are doing the open surgery, we were doing a three-dimensional surgery. So there was a depth perception, there was all the perception, and this is how the magnified view of the cystic duct and the cystic artery and the wide window here, it looked, this is a common bile duct here going into the liver, and this is what the technology changed our vision. And our operation theater suddenly had nothing on the ground, everything was hanging, and there were lot many monitors, as you see in this, there are lot many monitors on there rather than anything on the floor. So this is the modern operation theater which became a gold standard. So as we know, gold, whatever it may happen, the gold still remains gold, and that is why laparoscopic surgery became the gold standard surgery, at least for gallbladder, hernia, fundoplication, hysterectomy, appendectomy, and quite a number of them. But in the process, what we lost was one dimension. So from three-dimensional surgery, palpating the organ with the finger, having tactile sensation, looking at the depth perception was there, we moved on to and adopted a 2D technology. Like in COVID, we adopted a 2D technology from actual physical activities to virtual meetings, and now we are enjoying again the physical meetings as it used to be. So we lost one dimension and everything became flat on the screen. Many times we had to adjust our angles, adjust our hands to perform a particular surgery. I think, but every time from 1990 to 2000, for 10 years, every patient used to ask, "Sir, durbin se operation karana hai ya operation karana hai? Upar operation mein acche se operation ho jata hai." And in 2000, we operated His Excellency, President of India, Mr. K.R. Narayanan. It's now 22 years now, it's more than 22 years, 22 and a half years back. And that is the first time when any political person or any person who's so eminent, the first citizen of the country, relied on Indian subject, Indian surgeons, Indian hospitals. Otherwise, there used to be a tendency for people to go. You remember Dr. Sanjeeva Reddy went to Sloan Kettering Cancer Hospital. Everybody used to go abroad. And for the modern technology, this is the first time. And why I'm showing, when I operated him, he was 83 years of age, a sitting president of India. There are blue book protocols to operate President of India, because the command of the army is with him, the nuclear power is with him, the Chief Justice takes over. Like, it's not like a US where the president hands over it to the vice president, but the chief judicial officer, the chief Supreme Court, he takes over the command from the president. And then there is a cabinet meeting, there's a protocol book, who is going to operate, what is his background, I hope he is not going to kill the patient on the table, who will look after the country when the president is under anesthesia. But that was a great pride that we take, not as an individual, but it is the country we took that pride, and we are really grateful to. And this is 24 hours after his very, very difficult cholecystectomy. Then he walked, waved to the crowd, and that established the laparoscopic surgery in the country. Then nobody after that asked us, ki open operation karenge ya durbin se operation karenge. So this is the landmark which I wanted to share with you. I have been fortunate that I mean now this is the sixth president. I am still waiting, and hopefully we will get it in a couple of weeks, the letter of appointment. But I then served Kalam Saab as a surgeon to the president of India, and he was the second president. And Kalam Saab was such a sort of interesting person. He came to Gangaram Hospital to work on the endo trainer. Look at this, you know, he wanted to see, this is a simulation endo trainer, and he wanted to actually work and see how the laparoscopic surgery is done. And that was again thanks to him, and also a country like India, where the president itself is so keen to learn and spend the whole day in the lab to see how it is done. Then I was again fortunate to be the president's surgeon. I operated Mr. Alawat when Mrs. Patel was, and the president hosted a lunch for us. Then I was again appointed to Pranab Mukherjee Saab, and I operated his son. And then on 10th October 2008, again an historical, that we moved from nation to international person, a Nobel laureate, Dalai Lama, he got operated for his gallbladder in 2008. And we are going to be completing now, we are in August, September and October. And this is the team which did that. Again, he was a very senior person, and he chose Indian doctor, Indian surgeon. Though Condoleezza Rice was his disciple, and she was the foreign minister, foreign secretary at the time in US. She came to see him post-operatively in Gangaram Hospital, a secret vision. But we again felt that this is 24 hours after his surgery, he left the hospital. And very special blessings, you see, is a transmission. This is a very interesting photo. Somebody told me that he's transmitting the energy from his cheek to the hands, and it's like a fueling. So we have been very fortunate on that. But as you know, that technology, whatever technology is available to us today, definitely that technology is going to be outdated tomorrow. Or in other words, the technology is already outdated. Whatever telephone, whatever computer, whatever we are getting it, it's already outdated. And the companies are making it and preparing for the next this thing. So I think evolving technology should always be respected. As I think all of us, we move on every 1 year, 2 years, we change our telephone because the technology changes, the camera improves, the communication improves, the things become fast. So this is what happened, and I think it's important for all of us to understand that patients are our responsibility, and technology should be adopted for the benefit of the patient, not for the benefit of the doctor or to the hospital or to anything else. So it has come now. I would say 2021 was the time for us to move, and the movement was towards the robotic surgery. And 21 we could not sort of gather like this, but we moved in 21 to the robotic surgery and the technological development. Now, what happened that I got the reference, and now I think I'm sure you all must know that there is a robotic surgery for prostate cancer, for urological procedures, it is done already. That robot is Da Vinci robot, and that robot is not cost, if capital is this thing, but per case the cost has been very, very high. So I did not ventured into that, because and second thing, I did not like the idea that all the ports are to be made in one line, because the Da Vinci intuitive robot, your all ports are in one line, whereas now the robot I will be talking about is the robotic system from Cambridge Medical Robotics from Cambridge, and I think we should feel very lucky and proud as an Indian that the artificial intelligence of this robot has been provided by me in from 19 to 21. So whatever movements the robot is doing, the intelligence comes from my hand movements which I have done on the robotic system. For complications, how to create complications with robot, I spent a lot of time in Dubai on cadavers, the soft cadavers which are imported there. and you say injure the cystic artery, you injure the, you know, and the robot intelligence takes that you should, if you go there, you will injure. So in the modern robot, which we are talking about, the next generation robot, the robotic movement will tell you that you are not supposed to go. Like your car tells, you know, if some car comes close to you, your car tells you that this distance is very close. There are light, green lights, yellow lights, red lights in the car system, which tells you that don't go there. And some of the very expensive cars, even if you are very close to somebody, it will put an automatic brake also. Now you have seen the cars parking themselves because of the artificial intelligence. They park themselves. You find it difficult to park, but in a very small and narrow space, they park themselves. So this is the technological involvement, and artificial intelligence plays an important role. The previous generation of the robotic system did not have the artificial intelligence, and they will take a couple of years because they are stuck with one particular model. So now this is what I am talking about. As you can see, this is the next generation robot. Is the next generation robot, and this is a mobile robot. You see, all these arms, they are mobile. You can use 2 arms, you can use 3 arms, you can use 5 arms. It all depends how many instruments. So one surgeon, instead of having 2 arms, gets 4 or 5 arms. So you can, the detection can be done, the telescope is moved, the angle, the rotation, everything can be done by the surgeon. So you can imagine. Now another good point I will be discussing further is that you can move this operation from one operation table theater to another operation theater. So for example, today, till last year I was working with a 4 operation theater. This, from September 1st coming, we will have the 5th operation to us. So we will be working on the 5 operation theater. So the point is that the previous robotic system has to be fixed on the ceiling in one operation theater, and you can't do more than 1 or 2 cases. But we are able to do about 8, 9, 10 cases every day because the patients are demanding the robotic surgery because of precision. These are the arms which move, and you can see that this is the hand, and this is all rotated. Now, what is this? I would like to you to understand. I don't know whether we thought about that. You see, this is a shoulder of the robot. This is the elbow of the robot, and this is the wrist of the robot. Now, when you are writing something on the board, you are using shoulder, your elbow, and wrist. That means that your handwriting will be not as good on the board, right? But when you sign a check or you write something, you fix your shoulder, you fix your elbow on the table, and then you write. So the movements are done by only the wrist, and wrist does the finer movements. The shoulder and the elbow, they are doing the crude movements. So the biggest advantage which I would like you to understand is writing on the, your handwriting on the board and your handwriting on the table where your shoulder and elbows are fixed. So all robotic surgeries are done by the wrist. Now another thing is that my wrist can move only up to this. The robotic wrist moves 720 degrees because the joint. So if I move this much, the robot moves further. So my movements also become finer. And when I'm stitching, when I'm suturing, between the 2 sutures, the distance is absolutely equal, almost like what you do with the machines. And another advantage, of course, which I said, is the 3-dimensional. So there is a depth perception. So what has happened? The same laparoscopic surgery which I was doing on an average about 15 to 20 minutes it used to take, now it is taking about 8 to 10 minutes for us. Because of the 3-dimension, you know where you are going. Another point in, I don't know how, why we did not realize it fast. After using a robotic surgery since last year, we have realized that the cystic artery, a cystic duct, and you do investigation, IVC and all investigation, CT, etc., everything will come normal. So now we have realized in last 500 cases, we have completed 500 cases in a very short period. We have realized in majority of the patient, the cystic duct is joining posteriorly. But with laparoscopy, we cannot go posterior to the CBT because the chances of injury. But with robotic surgery, three-dimensional surgery, the accuracy is exact where the joint is, you know, you where the cystic duct, whatever is the angle it is connecting, you put the clip according to that. So that has given, I don't know whether it is going to be, but we are enjoying it because it becomes even more finer and more accurate. Now you see the robotic system moving from one operation theater to another operation theater. So biggest advantage, I think some of our colleagues and who have having a hospital, this is the system and you are sitting. Now another thing is that, you know, you are just moving the wrist and you can see the movement of the instruments. You are operating with your head rested, you know, and the tip is moving. You can see that the movement of the tip, how much is the movement of the tip, you know. At any angle you can walk on. And the accuracy increases. Another point which I would like you to note is that this robot has open console. In the previous intuitive robotic system, you had to dig in into the tunnel. You know, like you have to bend. And here you will see that, you know, you are sitting comfortably. The screen here is open, so you can talk to your anesthetist, you can talk to the team, you can give instructions to the team, and at the same time you are not tired, because otherwise in the previous robotic system, you know, there is a neck pain because of the cervical spondylosis, and I think all of us, we have those, that sort of problem. Second advantage to me is because of my passion and love for teaching and training the young surgeons, there can be 10 surgeons sitting behind me can see the same movement, same action which I am doing. So this is again the great advantage of the robotic system. Now you can see like that. Now you see that the hands are resting on this, this rest is there, and you are looking, is an open system. You have got everything, all controls under this thing, like a joystick, and you are only using the wrist, no shoulder, no elbow. This makes it precise. And three-dimensional gives more accuracy. Yeah. Everything, you are moving telescope, and if you want to stand up and operate, you can do this also, because the previous generation robotic system did not allow. You have to sit. Here, you can operate, and you know, you can sit and you can operate. This is a not a patient, it's a model, just for the demonstration purposes, and you can stand up depending on, suppose you are too tired to sit, you can stand up and operate. And the movements are very delicate movements, and that is what you enjoy the most. Now you see that this is a simple ball bender. You can see the angle of this, and here I am not able to show you the this thing, but you know, this is the cystic duct, and this is, I am going posterior into the common bile duct, and then you can cut and detach, and I don't think there is anything great about you, you all know about it. Now the liver cyst, this was a large case of complex liver cyst here. You may not be able to see it. Also at a gallstone. Now this is the liver cyst here. Huge right lobe liver. This is the liver cyst. But then with all precision you can do that and also take care of the liver pathology also. You can see the arm moving up and down. You don't have to, this is a wide window, and here I think you can see the liver cyst. Then after doing this, we moved on to the liver and did the cystectomy. The liver cyst, see such a large cyst here. First you aspirate, and when with ultracision you remove the cyst. You see the how the ions they move. Same thing, I think, is a TAPP for inguinal hernia. You can see the gap here. I will not go into this. This is the pubic bone here. And you can go deep and put in a mesh. And these are the mesh which fits into the place. And you put a tracker and then suture. Suturing becomes very simple and very easy with robotic system because of the angles. You see, within no time, you can suture it. And you can see the instrument which we are using, this instrument is the needle holder, this is the also, this is the telescope angle. So you can monitor each and every arm and every movement on that. Now this is a fundal plication, a very large sort of hiatus hernia, and this is what we are suturing the crust. You see the crust, and this is the mesh. So now this is the fundoplication. Again, the three-dimensional surgery is fantastic because the stomach goes into the chest, and the on one side is the lung, both sides are the lung, and the front is the heart beating. So you have to be very precise, especially when you are holding the energy sources. So this gives again a very great look. This is a gastric bypass. All bariatric surgeries are done, and you can see how the stomach is mobilized. I do not want to show you the steps, but you can see the angulation, and you can go to the second artery here. You can see this is the second short gastric artery on the lesser cuff, and with the precision you can go into that. You see, with this you can go like a snake. It's like a snake. You can move any direction, and of course the stepping and other things, which are at any angle you can hold these structures. And I think before, without, we did not actually realize, but suddenly when we did the 100th case, there was a call. We said that this is a world record which has been created, and the World Book of Record tells the fastest 100 robotic surgeries in the world. So I think, you know, we are very proud that we are all Indians here, and it is all recognized by the World Book of Records on this. So I think, you know, I would just like to conclude that we have known that our past will never change. What was laparoscopy, it will never change. It will always remain the past. Present, whatever we are doing, definitely tomorrow will become the past. So I'm sure the robotic surgery also will become the past, and the next generation will see what best is going to do. Future becomes present, and focus on present. So what is important is today, when you buy anything, when you look at the technology, you buy something which is the best, which you can afford. That talks about us in terms of cost. Now, I think you all know that the biggest handicap for all robotic surgery was the capital cost of about 15-16 crores of rupees, and per case cost, which used to be almost touching 1.5 to 2 lakhs. But with the present system, the charges which are extra are just 65,000 for all 4 or 5 arms, the draping of the arms, the instruments and everything. And that has been possible because for us, we have provided the artificial intelligence to the system, and they are using our artificial system across the globe. And the cost, I think, was 65,000 for robotic surgery, for most modern surgery, is practically nothing. Lot of insurance companies are giving it today, and lot of patients, they don't care because they say operation ek baar hoga life mein. And 65,000 practically for most of the patients who are coming to us, I would say, and coming to you, I would say, in Delhi, will not mind paying extra 65,000 rupees for any surgery, for hernia, fundoplication, bariatric surgery. So I think, you know, the first point which we discussed initially, that robotic surgery did not pick up in the past because first it was only installed in one operation theatre. So that operation theatre is blocked for the whole day. You can do at the most 2 surgeries, and that is why the cost was also going up. Now when you are able to do 7-8 surgeries, the extra cost of 65,000, I think most of the people are, that is the reason why we feel that people are actually going in, and I'm sure. And today, you said this is 796th CME, and I can promise you that you will remember possibly couple of months or maybe next year that this CME brought the transition of laparoscopic surgery into the robotic surgery. So I'm sure you will agree with me that this will be historical. Today we are talking of transition. Tomorrow all laparoscopic surgery in the country and the world will be doing laparoscopy with the help of robotic. And today 65, tomorrow it may be 40, it may be 30, or it may be nothing. So this is a giant leap of our faith which we have taken, and I just wanted to share all my thoughts to you, because I know it becomes my moral responsibility, and my responsibility as an individual to let our and the medical fraternity know what is the best for their patients today. So I feel with that gesture, and emotions which have been attached with you for decades, and I am really thankful to amount of love and respect and feelings you all give to us as a professional. So thank you very much once again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think you will all realize that Dr. it was like oration. We in all major conferences we keep a major oration. It was like an oration. We keep in ASI also. So I will request Dr. Vetu please sit here, and we'll have some questions and answers.
So first, sir, you
all said that when we shifted from open surgery to laparoscopic surgery, we lost 3D vision, and that has been compensated by robotic surgery.
No, I think we lost that, but we were happy that the patient did not have pain.
Yes.
They were walking around, and we had no other option. But now we have laparoscopy surgery, and the lost dimension has come back.
Yeah, that's why the whatever minus points of laparoscopic surgery is covered, and then whatever tactile sensation we are having less. Yeah. In robotic surgery, but it is overcome by the vision, 3D vision, and other magnified vision. Yeah. Also.
And also, I would say, you have asked a very delicate question. Instead of a tactile sensation, the robot gives you the pressure. How much pressure you are putting? Suppose you have one instrument, suppose there are four instruments, and one instrument is out of camera vision, the system will freeze. To tell you that one instrument is out of focus. And what that is damaging, where it is damaging, where it is puncturing, you have to be careful. So suddenly you realize that four instruments are under the camera, the fourth instrument is missing. And then you go back with your camera, with telescope, because everything is under control. And then you suddenly realize that it is touching the liver. This is one point. Second point is, if the instrument tip is touching, the organ, and there is a, they have decided the pressure. The pressure increases, again that instrument freezes. So if one instrument is touching any other organ, either abdominal wall or any, so after a certain pressure, I don't exactly know how much pressure, but there is a safety sort of thing, and it freezes. So you have to reboot again. Even your awaaz kyun aa rahi hai, why is it warning? As your car gives you warning, see if something comes closer.
This artificial intelligence also helps in when we are doing intestinal retraction and anastomosis. So you are not putting the clamp at right position. Does it help in that also?
Yes, because it shows you the alignment. Again, main abhi kaha tha, apne jo camera hai car mein, wo steering ka dikhate na, ki if you are turning the steering, there will be a curve which you can see kahan jayegi gaadi. Lot of cars have that. So exactly same, your instrument direction shows which direction the instrument is going and what it will hit if you continue going. So when you are booting this thing, and when you are putting in the instrument, you take the instrument, and the intelligence understand. You say, I don't want the instrument to go beyond this. So when I'm doing a hiatus hernia, so I, when I'm taking the instrument, the memory of the robot, I take the instrument right up to the hiatus and then stop there, and then it remembers. It will not go beyond that, because I know beyond that is a pleura, beyond that is a pericardium, so I don't want it to go. But when I release it, then I can override the robotic system. But you have to keep the press and then go beyond that, then the it will allow.
I think that is one advantage of robotic surgery. You can go deep into pelvis, deep into when we are doing hiatus hernia. Yeah. So that is one advantage. And one of advantage also in tremors. If we are doing laparoscopic surgery, surgeon, if they are having tremors, that is minimized by robotic surgery.
Zero.
So tremors, they know hard if surgery is tremor. So.
It increases the longevity of the surgeon. Because you know, I think a lot of our friends and colleagues we have seen, they develop Parkinsonism. Very intelligent, very senior surgeons, but they develop Parkinsonism. And that will not affect, that person can still
last day. Surgeons at 70, 75 also can do robotic surgery.
Easily.
So that is one advantage for surgeons also.
Yeah,
absolutely. And surgeons are less tired.
Less tired.
You said, particularly with new robot.
Yeah.
So they are less tired also. Yeah. They don't have to go inside control also.
Because all of us will be surviving. All the surgeons, all the doctors, because of the stress, you usually go through when you enter the medical college, stress of reading everything and passing. Then I think you know that position is very tiring, but this is open. You can stand up also. You are not scrubbing. You can stand up. You can talk to this thing. You can correct the port pressure. Come back again. Lot of advantage.
Before I open this. But just one point that I will mention here that this is still being done by surgeon, not robot. Robot is only helping like Chauve, Dr. Chauve or other surgeons. The surgery done by surgeon with the help of robot. So now it is open for question answer. Dr. Kalra,
yes.
It robotic system enhances the skill and safety of the surgeon.
But surgeon has to control it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like aircraft.
Yes, sir.
What a wonderful and mesmerizing talk, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
मुझे अभी तक होश नहीं आया.
Thank you, thank you.
मैं शायद एक पैक और दूंगा फिर मुझे होश
आएगा. Sir, I will give you a complete.
Sir, let me ask two brief questions.
Yeah.
They are not my questions.
Yeah.
वो आपकी comments पे हैं.
Please sit
down. अभी आपने बताया कि Parkinsonism. A person, a doctor with Parkinson can also operate on robots. I remember one of my teachers, Dr. Parmar, he is now no more. I'm from 74 batch, he was my teacher. So he had a driver because he developed Parkinsonism. So he could not drive a car. So can a person with a Parkinsonism work on robots in a surgery?
Yeah, mild to moderate, I'm sure. Unless his major joints move. It's only if his minor joints, the hands are shaking more, it can do this. If the neck is also moving, that also is alright because it's three dimensional surgery. The dimension doesn't change.
Sir.
But of course, severe by that time, I would say that a lot of carriers are spoiled because of early Parkinsonism, or it may be just a benign tremor. It may not be Parkinsonism also.
Sir, this should not be counted my question.
Yeah.
It was a pre-question. Another pre-question is, sir, I want to congratulate you for your 90,000. 90,000 means we have been congratulating Tendulkar for 100 centuries. Yeah. You have 900 centuries. Sir, how much time will it take to have 1,000 centuries?
Maybe for God is kind, 2 years. Because I am doing about 4,000 surgeries every year.
Sir, my question starts. Does cholecystectomy matter if a person has been done cholecystectomy or a person has a normal gallbladder and you are doing his bariatric surgery? Will the outcome differ? Because there is a role of bile salts and bile acids.
So, you are talking about the normal gallbladder?
If it's a bariatric surgery or metabolic surgery, on a person who has been done cholecystectomy versus a person has normal gallbladder.
No difference. Let me tell you. So when we do bariatric surgery, for first 6 months we know that the patient is going to lose 6 to 8 kg per month, right? It's our average which we get. So for six months, we give them Udenil as a preventive for gallstone. And of course, ultrasound is done preoperatively, so we know that there is no gallbladder stone. But if the patient on ultrasound shows gallbladder stone and we are doing bariatric surgery, we do cholecystectomy also and bariatric surgery also.
Right. So I've seen a bit, some of my friends having lost, say, drastically over a short period, a lot of weight, and they developed gallstones. So I think gallstone is a possibility.
Yes.
So I see all the ICU patients when they are on ventilator. If you recollect, all our intensivists, they give them UDLIP. So that during that period, when they are losing weight, or the cachexic patients, or terminal malignancy patients who are losing weight, in that patient is always better for all of us. I will recommend that those patients should be covered by UDLIP. Or any one of our family member is going in for weight loss, whether it is surgical or medical, or with some GLP analogs and
other things. Diet and all that.
So it's always better to give them UDLIP.
Right.
When they are using it.
Sir,
we have.
Why?
Jail.
How does
it help? By preventing the gallstones. As many of the gynecologists give in the patients where there is a cholestasis, you know, they give the
it's called the fatty liver.
Fatty liver.
I'm just giving, sir. Yeah. Sir, we have progressed from normal surgery to the laparoscopy or say laparoscopic surgeries, and then to robotic. What is the next imagination? What is the, are you going towards tele-surgery?
Well, with robotic surgery, today's 5G coming in. Now, I don't know whether it is very exciting what we talk. And you brought this subject up with 5G coming. It is quite possible that you may be operating anywhere.
But the leg surgery is not going to be
Leg period. This surgery will have to be
operated. Sir, my simple question is, we know about 360 degrees. You said something about 720. Is it clockwise and
twice?
It is clockwise and counterclockwise.
Right? Twice. It can turn twice.
It is twice.
And why twice?
Sir, my last question about the role of incretins. So how does it differ when we give AGI, which delays the gastric emptying? It has an incretin effect. And when you fasten the gastric emptying by bypass, it has an incretin effect. What is the difference between the two? And do we need EPP4 after your surgery? Because if you increase GLP-1, which will be degraded by the normal EPP4 enzyme.
Yeah, your answer is the anti-incretins. The incretins, over a period of time, they have seen that there is another protein which are totally opposite to incretins. They are known as anti-incretins. So what happens, those anti-incretins are produced in the duodenum and first part of jejunum. So in gastric bypass, we always bypass the first part of jejunum and duodenum. So that anti-incretins are like dogs, very interesting. Anti-incretins are like dogs. If the food is going into the duodenum in first part of jejunum, they will bark. So they will engage the incretins, you know. So that incretins, very few incretins will be left. And that is how they develop insulin resistance. And more insulin you keep on giving. And body starts producing more and more antibodies of anti-incretin. So this is a theory of anti-incretin and incretin. Another is a gut theory, a distal gut theory, where the food reaches the ileum first and then GLPs are stimulated. So those are the two theories, foregut and hindgut theory.
I think
that's so. This is the length and coverage, this thing. What is the total cost of the package? And
just 65, any operation, any laparoscopy,
only 65,000.
Only 65,000
extra than
laparoscopy.
Extra,
yes. So what is the total package?
No, it all depends on if you have a
polycystectomy,
I think it should be about 85,000 plus 65,000.
Then how are the companies charging out of 65,000?
The companies are not charging anything. The hospital purchases that and they pay, they have already paid, bought it. And there are paper models also.
Like models of here are the robotics of next free of cost. And they're charging for surgery.
But then the charges become more. Of then it is 95,000. So then you are not paying the capital investment.
So two questions.
What are you doing? 95% I am doing gastric bypass for the last 25 years.
Sleep,
we don't like very much because it causes regurgitation. And I am mortally scared of barrex esophagus.
Okay.
So, and suppose you are doing sleep in a young patient, the barrex esophagus will develop. And then, if you want to excise the esophagus, the stomach is not available to come up. Otherwise, if the patient has got a full stomach, and when you excise the esophagus, you take the sleeve of the stomach up. So for a barrex esophagus or esophagus, the stomach is not available.
So when you are doing sleeve and patient is having reflux, can you do empty reflux procedure with sleeve?
No, it will not work.
It will not work.
No, because already the esophagogastric junction is already divided.
Dr. Chopra,
yeah.
Sir, I am Dr. Vinod.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah,
sir, आपने बहुत बढ़िया समझाया हमको. मेरा ये क्वेश्चन है कि क्या ये जो आप लोग रोबोट्स को एलो कर रहे हैं सर्जरी करने के लिए, क्या ये पॉसिबल है कि 10-15 साल या 20-25 साल के बाद हमारे जो बच्चे जो डॉक्टर्स हैं आने वाले हैं उनको सर्जरी करने भी देंगे? जो आप आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस की बात कर रहे हैं, जो आप आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस की बात कर रही है, गूगल अभी गाड़ियां चला रहा है रोड पे और कोई एक्शन नहीं हो रहा है. सर आप ये देखिए, अगर 15-20 साल के बाद या 10 साल के बाद ये सॉफ्टवेयर काम करेगा और आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस पे काम करेगा तो सर हमारी जरूरत खत्म हो जाएगी.
नहीं, आई एम टेलिंग यू, आप जो बात बोल रहे हैं, क्योंकि डिसीजन तो आपको लेना पड़ेगा, डिसीजन आपको करना पड़ेगा. तीसरी बात यह है कि जब आपका रोबोट का फायदा क्या होगा, अगर गवर्नमेंट की बात करें तो जब आपका इंस्ट्रूमेंट राइट हेपेटिक आर्टरी के पास जाएगा और जब उसका पल्सेशन देखेगा तो देयर विल बी अ वार्निंग, राइट हेपेटिक आर्टरी आएगा, बी केयरफुल. जैसे आपकी कार में वार्निंग आती, कोई भी स्कूटर वाला आपकी गाड़ी के सामने से जाता है तो ब्लिप 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 करता है, सो यू नो कि कुछ गड़बड़ है. आप रिवर्स कर रहे हैं, पीछे का कैमरा ब्लिप ब्लिप करने लगता है, देयर इज अ ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन, सो इट इज वार्निंग. यू कैन ओवर राइड, आपकी आप कार में गवर्नर लगा हुआ है 60 किलोमीटर से आप ज्यादा स्पीड बढ़ेगी तो वो वार्निंग देगा कि आपको 60 किलोमीटर से ज्यादा होगी. It is up to you to take note of it. Or
you don't take. Sir, I congratulate you that you are a great surgeon and you are a surgeon of India and you are a surgeon of the world. सच्ची मैं आपको फॉलो कर रहा हूँ. जब से आपने बहुत सारे सर्जरीज किए हैं और बहुत सारे पॉलिटिशियंस को उनका मैं नाम नहीं लेना चाहता हूँ जिन्हें जिनकी आपकी सर्जरी की है. सर आई रियली सैल्यूट यू एंड यू आर ए ग्रेट जेंटलमैन एंड रियली सर जी, आपने जो काम किया है जो बिल्कुल सराहनीय है और जितने भी ये हमारे जो बाहर के देश के जो सर्जन्स हैं जिन्होंने आपके बराबर 1/20 भी काम नहीं किया है उनको बहुत बड़े अवार्ड मिलते हैं एंड आई रियली सैल्यूट यू सर. सर आपने हमारे बहुत सारे पेशेंट्स को इलाज किया है, आई रियली सैल्यूट यू सर. सर आप हम जैसे देखिए हम जो एक छोटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है आप हमारे लिए सर एक गुरु हैं और रियली आई अप्रिशिएट दैट यू हैड कम एंड आई सैल्यूट यू सर. And you are really a great job, sir. Sir, आप सर्जरी के गुरु हैं. And I really appreciate, sir.
And you made my own job.
Yeah, yeah. I think there is a question for Dr. C.
Awards, Dr. Chauve, को बहुत मिले हैं. तो वो ये ऐसा नहीं है internationally. He has got many awards recognition. So he known all over the world.
Dr. Pradhan, sir.
Yes.
Sir, we have a question from Dr. Sen.
Yes, Dr. Sen Gupta. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Sir, thank you very much for your lovely lecture.
Thank you, sir.
And taking us through the time frame of the evolution of the surgery. Just a very small comment regarding the operative things done under precedence. I mean, when we were juniors at Sarvajan Hospital, there was one Dr. Santosh Sen.
Yeah.
And Sen Nursing Home used to be a landmark just next to the present ITO, which is no longer existing.
I'm sure you know
that
it.
Was before 50.
First time, yeah. President of India, Rajendra Prasad,
yes,
went for his cataract surgery,
yeah,
in nursing home.
It's not only that, sir, when he had a prosthetic enlargement,
yeah,
and he was refused by even the Guy's Hospital in London. And Santosh Sen wanted to operate. Santosh Sen had an unfortunate, dubious reputation of running away with the ambassador's wife. Thanks to Nehru, he was always clear for whatever reason.
Dr. Sen
went but then, the prosthetic enlargement surgery which was done by Santosh Sen was accomplished in a record of 16 minutes in those times, which was not DORP. He was granted the Padma Shri after that. So I think that was one of the first instances when the President of India was operated on by an renowned surgeon in the country. And Santosh Sen was a remarkable surgeon. And we all know that, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Chauhan, you can ask some questions.
Dr. Sajid, can you
ask some questions?
I just wanted to ask, are there any failure rates with robotic surgery?
Any?
Failure.
See, the another great advantage of the CMR robot is the port placement is exactly the same what you do for laparoscopy. So, it's not a question of failure. Sometimes there may be gangrene, there may be very tough tissue, which may not be possible. So what you do is just pull out, it takes 1 second to pull out that instrument. One button and it comes out. And then you put your regular laparoscopic instruments and continue.
What percentage of patients have become
yours? For us, less than 1%.
Yeah, Dr. Grigesh, 1%.
Yeah. I'm Dr. Grigesh Yadav, and medicine Chhatrapur. सर मैंने बहुत सारे पेशेंट देखे हैं ओपन सर्जरी वाले जिनको इंसिजनल हर्निया होता है, सेकेंडरी लेप्रोसी लेप्रोस्कोपिक देखे हैं उनको भी इंसिजनल हर्निया देखा मैंने 2-3 पेशेंट को, रोबोटिक सर्जरी में क्या इंसिजनल हर्निया होता है?
नहीं, आई विल टेल यू द प्रीवियस जनरेशन रोबोट सिस्टम इंट्यूटिव.
एक और सवाल है
जी,
पहले इनका जवाब तो ले
लो. लेप्रोस्कोपिक में थ्री होल्ड करते हैं.
फोर ही हो जाते हैं.
थ्री और फोर ही और मैक्सिमम टाइम फोर.
सर नहीं, मैं तो थ्री देखे
हैं. अरे आपने थ्री कम देखे, मैं आपने सर्जरी कम देखी.
चलो बोलो. हां नोट कर.
हां इसी
हां नोट कर.
वो आप यहां पे देख रहे हो ना, एक्चुअली ऑनलाइन से
हमारा तो थ्री
है. अब लाइकस जो फोर रहता है वो दिखता नहीं इससे.
जी सर,
अब लाइकस में लाइकस पे की नोट आप यहां पे देखिए.
सर आस्क द क्वेश्चन डॉक्टर विजेश.
The new generation, next generation robot, the chances of hernia is zero. Why? Because the port size is 5 millimeters, and with the 5 millimeter port, the incision hernias and port hernias will not happen. You must have seen port hernia after TLH. You must have seen port hernia after prosthetic surgery, because for delivery of that organ, one port is 15 millimeter. So if there is a 15 millimeter, but it will not occur from 5 millimeter port. It may occur from 15 millimeter port. Sometimes they need to cut the muscles also, because the bulk is so much. Let's say for example, splenectomy. When I am doing splenectomy, I have to make a small incision for the spleen to come out. So in those cases, from where you take out the organ, there may be incision on there, because that is basically an incision.
Sir, when we use 10 mm port in epigastric area to take out the gallbladder sometimes,
yeah.
So do you recommend to close the seat there with proline?
No, I may not, because you see, there is a trick for a surgeon like you. You just go. So the puncture in the anterior rectus sheath is at different level.
Okay. At different level, puncture.
Yes.
Will be at
so it's a flap line. It's a flap line.
Yeah. No, no, no.
Final aspects of
Doctor Mangla sir, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to ask you about thousands of employees. What 40% of cases that suspect that problem at the pain comes. Majority cure may
happen. No, I mentioned very clearly, I don't know whether with taking the posterior reduct, the posterior insertion will help or not. But we do come across, now we recollect that the patient comes after 4 years, 3 years, says if the lower and axilla that aapne operation kiya tha. Then generally you say ki dekho government is the hand. Aapka aur agar aap koi bhi ultrasound karoge koi foreign body nahi hai. Par aapko kyun dard ho raha hai? Ho sakta hai liver enlargement ho. Ho sakta hai koi intestinal hurry ho. So अभी तो हमको हमारे पास में कोई ऑल्टरनेटिव नहीं है एक्सेप्ट टू से दैट वी डोंट नो व्हाई यू आर हैविंग पेन देयर इज नो डिजीज देयर इज नो पैथोलॉजी देयर इज नथिंग व्हिच कैन बी डिटेक्टेड आइदर ऑन सीटी और यू गेट एमआरसी भी डन एमआरसी भी शोस अ स्मॉल सिस्टिक डक्ट स्टब देयर एंड यू कैन नॉट से बिकॉज़ देयर इज नो ट्रीटमेंट फॉर दैट इफ यू आस्क द पेशेंट आप दोबारा ऑपरेशन कराइए मैं सिस्टिक डक्ट स्टब निकाल दूंगा नोबडी विल गेट कि 0.5 सेंटीमीटर के लिए कौन जाएगा एंड हु विल डेयर टू गो बिहाइंड द
वी आर नॉट स्टिल नॉट श्योर दैट
आई एम नॉट श्योर सर आई एम नॉट श्योर
वी यूज टू कॉल इट पोस्ट कोलेस्टेक्टोमी सिंड्रोम सो दैट इज दैट इंक्लूड्स अ वैरायटी ऑफ वन मे बी सिस्टिक डक्ट रेमिनेंट
अनदर इज द रेमिनेंट स्टोन इन द रेमिनेंट द सर्जन हैज लेफ्ट दिस यू नो
स्टोन इन द सिस्टिक डक्ट आई जस्ट
वांट टू आस्क जी एसिम्प्टोमेटिक गॉलस्टोन्स एसिम्प्टोमेटिक गॉलस्टोन्स will still recommend them surgery yeah. because we know that gallbladder cancer is a very bad cancer. And if somebody has a history of the malignancy in a patient, has gallstone, would you recommend the gallbladder be out?
Yeah. ये मैं बहुत बड़ा मैसेज आप लोगों को देना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि आप लोग मेरे को इसको बहुत गलत कर सकते हैं gallbladder complications at least I would say I'm operating 350 to 400 surgeries But at the same time, at any given time, I have 4 or 5 patients in ICU on ventilator with pancreatitis, with you know the problems with perforated gallbladders, gangrenous gallbladders going into septicemia, and then you say कि पहले हमको बोला था कि चुपचाप पढ़ा हुआ पढ़ रहे थे। मैं सिर्फ एक मैसेज देना चाहता हूँ। First of all, Indian genes, I can actually give you the name of those genes. So Indian genes are good. Or are labeled with the carcinoma gallbladder. This is highest number of carcinoma gallbladder is in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. And the origin was Ganges, जो गंगा रिवर के किनारे रहे But अगर हम बोलेंगे कि चेन्नई में भी जो आदमी है वो पहले कभी ना कभी गंगा के किनारे रहा है उसके जीन्स मस्ट बी द पेरी क्योंकि कोई भी सभ्यता नदी के किनारे सभ्यता बनी है भले हम उसके बाद में हजारों किलोमीटर दूर चले गए सो आई थिंक फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल प्लीज रिमेंबर दिस इज अ प्रिवेंटेबल कैंसर गॉलब्लैडर कैंसर फॉल्स इनटू प्रिवेंटेबल कैंसर थ्योरेटिकली अगर आप पूरी इंडिया का अल्ट्रासाउंड करा दें और जिस जिसको गॉलब्लैडर में स्टोन है उसके आप निकाल दें गॉलब्लैडर यू विल बी शॉक्ड टू नो दैट द गॉलब्लैडर मैलिगनेंसी विल बिकम जीरो अनफॉर्चुनेटली ऑल ऑफ अस वी रीड द वेस्टर्न Hamilton Maggie, Valley and Love, and all those foreign books. उसमें इंडिया की जीन्स के बारे में कभी डिस्क्राइब नहीं किया जाता. That is one. और now हमारे कलीग्स यहाँ पे हैं. The lady while pregnancy gets a gallstone. Now that lady should not be allowed or suggested to become pregnant. Because we see actually itself I've done a lady with a 6 months pregnancy whose gallbladder was known to have a gallstone and today unfortunately I have to do those I did the micro lab and we put a very low pressure instead of 12-14 but the uterus is there how many surgeons I don't want to say but how many surgeons will be able to do a cholecystectomy at the intra-abdominal pressure of 5 or 6 where the whole abdomen is closed where you the anesthetist does not allow you to raise the head does not allow you to the tilt to the left You know,
very difficult.
It's very difficult. So, you know, if that lady would have been advised कि आपको gallstone है, please don't plan the pregnancy. एक दिन सुबह आपको जाएगा gallbladder stone. दोपहर तक आया था. We are not doing any surgery. All micro laparoscopies and the disease is gone. Then you become pregnant next day. It doesn't matter. Safety is very important. पहले जमाने में क्या होता था? Reluctance थी. तब बड़ा incision. हफ्ते 10 रोज का एडमिशन, फिर उसका इंसीजन लग गया, फिर पुनः इन्फेक्शन. सो दैट बैड इंप्रेशन इज गॉन इनटू आवर माइंड. बट टुडे आप उसका मैं दूसरा भी आपको एग्जांपल देता हूँ. आज आपके फ्रेंड के बच्चे की शादी है बॉम्बे में, यू डोंट माइंड. सुबह की फ्लाइट लेके आप गए, शाम को फंक्शन अटेंड किया, नेक्स्ट डे आप दूसरे फ्लाइट लेके यू आर बैक. आज से 20 साल 25 साल 30 साल पहले आप दो दिन आप ट्रेन में जाते, फिर वहाँ उतरते, कपड़े चेंज करते, पूरे काले हो गए होते, फिर रिजर्वेशन कराते, फिर वापस आते. नॉट पॉसिबल.
सो थैंक यू सर फॉर गिविंग दिस मैसेज दैट इवन एसिम्प्टोमेटिक कोलिशन शुड बी ऑपरेटेड एंड वन इंपॉर्टेंट रीजन इज टू प्रिवेंट मैलिग्नेंसी एंड यू
पेशेंट कॉन्फिगरेशन आल्सो.
या
स्पेशली बिकॉज अनदर वेरी फाइन एस्पेक्ट, द सिस्टिक आर्टरी इज एन एंड आर्टरी, दैट गॉट नो कोलेटरल्स. सो जरा सा भी अगर एथेरोस्क्लेरोसिस होती है, छोटी सी आर्टरी है, एथेरोस्क्लेरोसिस होती है, इसका ब्लड सप्लाई खत्म हो जाता है. The whole government becomes gangrenous, like the gangrene food or diabetic food for that matter. Especially when diabetic patients will not have biliary colic, like they don't have because of the neuropathy, the visceral neuropathy.
So in diabetic, you have to operate a silent cholesterol also.
Yeah, and I always say this is a bomb, whether it is exploded or not exploded. So instead of calling a silent governmental stone, we should call a
Unexploded, yeah, we should operate asymptomatic cholesterol, particularly in diabetic mice. Dr. Johan, yes, sir, what about gold medal polyp? Polyp is a soft tumor. Madam, see, lot of biliary pancreatitis which we used to see before used to be, there were three categories. One was the alpha-linked pancreatitis, another biliary, and third was idiopathic. Now madam, this is idiopathic.
Because ultrasound were not powerful. आप क्रिकेट में भी देखिए पहले बॉल कहाँ जा रही है किसी को नहीं मालूम था. आज के कैमरे ऐसे कि आपको बॉल घूमती हुई सीन दिखती है कि कैसे घूम रही है. तो वही सेम थिंग हैपेंड विद अल्ट्रासाउंड. दे वेर ए कैलकुलस कोलिसिस्टाइटिस माइक्रो माइक्रोलेज एंड और अगर वो बेचारा ऐसे शाम में कभी बिस्किट की पीता तो बोलते हैं अल्कोहल बंद कर दो, यू हैव डेवलप्ड अल्कोहलिक पैंक्रियाटाइटिस बिकॉज इट जनरली हैपेंस आफ्टर टेकिंग एन ईल.
So it should be operated. Second reason is even if 1% of gallbladder polyp is converted into malignancy, so it is a medical legal issue. So you have to tell the patient whether it is his decision or her decision not to get operated. Yes. But we should advise gallbladder polyp also to get operated.
Paper में लिखा होना चाहिए कि advice policy.
So it is any theoretical chance of turning into malignancy. Dr. Chauhan.
Sir, some simple questions.
Yes.
Wonderful talk, as always. It's a pleasure, and I would say it is an honor to listen to you any time.
Thank you, sir.
For on behalf of everyone, sir, despite all despite all the advancements that we have made in the field of surgery, laparoscopic, minimal invasive, and now robotic, do we still get complications like CVD stenting?
That is the reason why, as I said, training and teaching is important. So when you are using a cautery, our anatomy book says that the gallbladder is like this, and you know gallbladder is coming and getting attached. But practical, all laparoscopic surgeons will tell that the gallbladder, in many cases, is lying on top of the common biliary. It's lying on the top, and when you pull it, you divide it, then you see impression on the common biliary. So those are the cases where cautery should be used judiciously. That is where the training of the surgeon will come into picture. And that is also with that same philosophy. I have kept my doors open for last 35 years for anybody to come any day. All doors are open, there are no charges, there is no permission, nothing. Except the patient should not be a relative. You come, you walk in, you come to us, merge together all the surgeons, and they learn the small tricks. Like I was just telling, putting a port, how to put the port. You know, once you put in a port, hernia will not occur. So I think it's training and teaching is very important. And why we may call ourselves that, okay, we are seasoned surgeon, because we have been training. So when you are training another surgeon, you are learning. So in the process, instead of saying that I am teaching you, actually I should say that I am learning from you. It's a very important message.
Sir, another question that I want to ask you, in patients who have had recurrent cholecystitis, at times the gallbladder is actually totally stuck up with the liver bed.
in such cases, do you still go in for a minimal invasive surgery,
yeah,
oblique robotic surgery,
yeah,
or you would prefer an open surgery?
No, no. For last 25 years, I have not converted a patient. I will do it tomorrow. Last 25 years. We have done portal hypertension where the whole government is surrounded. But it's a delicacy which you know. You are a fighter pilot, you know, you have to see how you have to be.
Sir, you can sit.
Yeah, yeah.
You can sit, sir.
Then no problem. But yes, everybody should know the limitation. If they do the bad asset, safely. There is no point in driving a car at 120 when you cannot control. And race drivers will drive 200 kilometers, 200 miles. Doesn't matter. But all surgeons, they should know their limitation. The limitation of the equipment which they are using, how good is their disease, what is the team like. You don't want when you are close to portal hypertension. There are varicose things, their portal cavernomas are there. So those are tricky cases. But I still feel that kuch log mein hota hai, agar nahi lagta to it's better to send to the experienced people. You should know ki nahi hai aise nahi complex cases.
Sir, another question, because many of my colleagues who are here, they are physicians. And when we were studying Maulana Zahar, our professors like Dr. D.D. Goyal and the legend,
yeah,
they used to hear a term called interval cholecystectomy.
Yeah.
Like interval appendicectomy.
Yeah.
Now, if I have a patient who is type 2 diabetic, uncontrolled sugars, and I know, I have proven that he has got a gallstone, and this gentleman has got an acute or chronic cholecystitis. Is there a scope for interval cholecystectomy?
No.
No.
Not with the experienced biliary surgeon.
You go ahead and operate him at the next?
Any time of the
night. Any time of the night.
Sometimes operation during acute cholecystitis is easier than open.
Because the
visualization is much better.
In continuation of the same thing, sir, I want to ask you, at times, these patients of acute and chronic cholecystitis also have associated pancreatitis. Do you operate them,
yeah,
in a setting of acute pancreatitis,
yes,
also?
Yes. I will tell you, our protocol is very simple. Patient comes to us with a biliary pancreatitis, we admit them. We evaluate, we see that the CBD is clear or not clear. We have an endoscopic ultrasound, we know whether it is a sludge or not. Now, when the patient starts improving, if there is a stone, of course you should do a phlebotomy and put in a stent and drain it. My protocol in my department is we don't send the patient back. The moment the pancreas enzymes start settling down, we do the cholecystectomy and send the patient. Because then you have removed the bomb outside. Because many of these patients, while they are waiting, so the patient comes to us like that. When they are waiting for that interval, and before that interval happens, another stone goes into the common bile. They develop again pancreatitis. So our protocol is we send the patient after doing cholecystectomy for pancreatitis to recover. Because recovery of pancreatitis is separate issue, and re-pancreatitis we want to avoid. So our protocol is like the pattern should be downwards, the enzyme should be settling down, it may not touch zero. You can see the patient feeling well, start hunting, his appetite is good. So we do one and next day.
So, but that is only in mild pancreatitis.
Mild pancreatitis.
In severe pancreatitis, you can't operate. In mild pancreatitis, when it's recovering, then you can operate in the same situation.
Sir, years ago when we had that talk in Select City, behind the Select City,
yeah, yeah,
I asked you a very simple question. And you said that you have asked a very, very sensitive question today about bariatric surgery. And the guidelines about 6-7 years ago on bariatric surgery as well as CGHS permission is concerned. What is the status today? Do we have permission, clear cut permission,
yes,
for bariatric surgery,
yeah,
approved by CGHS?
Yeah, yeah. I'm the witness on 17.
You were in the committee.
Yeah,
you were in the committee at that time.
Yeah.
Now we have guidelines for,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
But what about TPA, sir?
TPA, STAR and some of them they are giving today. The only thing is, our cutoff time, BMI is 37.5, the insurance cutoff is 40. For Asians, in 2008, I submitted the white paper to the Government of India, where India's BMI cutoff is 2.5 less because of the metabolic conditions. We are all of this is a metabolic
syndrome. So, but they have not accepted this.
No, 2.7 is 37.5 without diabetes and 32.5 with diabetes.
Dr. Gandhi had a question.
So it's only person like you who can influence that TPA. Your recommendation will be very important.
We are getting it. Yes,
sir, what about robotic surgery? Is it reimbursable by CGHS?
At the moment. No, no. Unfortunately, CGHS for any cholecystectomy, open, closed, in the air, in the space, gives 80,500. Full stop. So, space suddenly fees, anesthesia fees, operation data, equipment, claim, disposables, everything is included. And that is the reason why it's a very sad situation. Not many institutions are willing to take that. And then legal responsibility remains the same. If you will be sued, he will say, I am secretary to the government, my 3.5 lakh rupees tanka hai, and I have 20 years of income, so crore rupees. So that is also point which is very interesting.
Very important.
I always, चाहे वो चीफ जस्टिस हो चाहे सुप्रीम कोर्ट जस्टिस, मैं हमेशा उनसे बोलता हूँ सर कि आप ये कैसे बोलते हैं कि इसको 2.5 करोड़ का कंपनसेशन दे दो, अगर हम 500 रुपये का कंसल्टेशन ले रहे हैं तो टाटा बिरला भी आएगा तो हम 500 रुपये कंसल्टेशन ले रहे हैं, सो व्हाई डोंट यू से कि भाई 10 times ऑफ योर कंसल्टेशन is the maximum, suppose
I am fighting on this,
yes.
The compensation should not be on the basis of the income of the patient.
Correct.
That is the income of the doctor. Because the patient, if a money comes to a doctor, he will sue for 100 crores, so doctors to bech dega pure property sab bhi nahi de payega anyway. So I am fighting on this.
अपोलो आ गया सब हॉस्पिटल को बोला और आपकी ये पर्टिकुलर सर्जरी करनी है आप कितना चार्ज करोगे, ये कहते हैं मैं 500 चार्ज करूंगा, ये कहते हैं मैं 600 करूंगा, ये कहते हैं मैं 800 करूंगा, जो मिनिमम होता है वो एक्सेप्ट होता है. And that will be applicable to
everybody. But sir, कैसे हो सकता है 148 रुपये में, तो मैं बोलता हूँ कि आप अगर आप 500 रुपये ले रहे हैं तो 148 रुपये उसके रिवर्स कर, और वो अभी मैक्स हॉस्पिटल को 280 करोड़ रुपये
बाकी है
ले रहे हैं, तो कहाँ से आप वो 148 रुपये का कंसल्टेशन लेके कर सकते
हैं. What a wonderful talk and so active interaction. सर मैं बता नहीं सकता कि मैं गदगद हो गया, दो पैग और लेने पड़ेंगे सुनने के लिए. सर प्लीज, आई जस्ट वांट टू नो, वी न्यू 4 F's, फीमेल, फेयर, फर्टाइल, 40 फॉर गॉल ब्लड, आई डोंट थिंक दे आर वैलिड22, 23, 25 years females having gallstones, उनको कब से शुरू हुआ होगा? हमने तो अब किया ना अल्ट्रासाउंड. So what are the causes causing this accelerated gallstones? Can you give some?
There is actually there may be no definite cause, but what we have seen probably the diagnosis has become so simple. First, when we were students, we were doing OCG, oral polycystography, which is to take 12 tablets, two bolis,
एक बार फिर मिलो
सर एनी टाइम आई जस्ट फॉर माय आई रिटेन योर फोन नंबर टेलीफोन नंबर आल्सो
चलो गुड
या नो जॉन फ्रेंड्स ऑपरेटिंग सो जस्ट प्लीज सेंड एसएमएस आई विल कम बैक टू
आई थिंक वी हैड अ वंडरफुल टॉक बाय बाय अ टू लीजेंड इन द फील्ड ऑफ मिनिमल इनवेसिव रोबोटिक सर्जरी व्हाटएवर यू कॉल इट एंड वी आर ब्लेस्ड टू हैव डॉक्टर प्रदीप चौबे सर